There we go. It's a go.
Thanks everybody for coming out. My name is Jamie Hubbard. I teach Buddhist studies here at Smith College. And I want to thank our sponsors for this, the Buddhist studies, the concentration in Buddhist studies here at Smith College, the Smith College Religion Department, the Ada Help Kent Fund in Non-Western Religions, and the Smith College Lecture Fund. We always have to thank everybody who gives us money. Not that they're out there listening. It's a karmic thing, I'm figuring. I know that I don't really have to say too much about this topic to this particular group that's out here. Buddhist meditation has become extremely popular in recent years, we all know this. And not just in Buddhist settings, but studied by neuroscientists and practiced in mindfulness-based stress reduction courses in your local high schools and elementary schools. This phenomenon is very interesting, but very few people realize that this mass mindfulness movement is a rather recent Burmese development, I mean recent by 150 years or so, and that it was in many ways thought to be kind of an ideal counterpart to the modern forms of religion that were being brought to the Burmese by their colonial rulers and colonial educational systems. This modern form of Buddhism was rational and scientific. The goals not restricted to the monastics, that is, open to the laity. Not consistent with ritual practice, belief in spirits, demons, or magic, and ultimately founded on psychological principles of an individual inner science, that is, meditation. It's interesting, of course, that this so-called individual form of practice, this meditation practice, was rooted in an entire people's resistance to colonialism. It was a mass meditation movement dominated by lay Buddhists and very successful in uniting disparate Burmese peoples in their opposition to colonialism. So, you ramp on about 100 years down the line, and Western seekers of awakening from the 60s and onwards discovered this rational, scientific, and individual practice of meditation. After years of ardent practice, they brought these traditions back to the West and founded some of the most important Buddhist meditation centers in America, right here in Massachusetts. Ran forward a few more years, and several clinical psychologists take these practices out of the meditation centers and into medical schools, again, right here in Massachusetts. So we have the birth of mindfulness-based stress reduction, a new mass meditation movement. Again, centered here in Massachusetts. So we've been hosting this series. This is the second. Last week, I'm sure many of you were here when David Mahan talked. Tonight, we have Erik Braun. I'll say in a moment something about that in a moment. On Thursday, the 23rd of October, we have Ingrid Jort, who is from the University of Wisconsin, who wrote a book called Burma's Mass Lay Meditation Movement, Buddhism and the Cultural Construction of Power. And then we kind of leave the Burmese roots behind a little bit and come more into what's going on around here and some of the more modern developments. And so Thursday, November 13th, is Willoughby Britton, who is a neuroscientist at Brown University and has written a whole lot of interesting things. Right now, I think she's getting more press for her Dark Night project than many other things, discussing some of the difficulties that might arise out of meditation. It's not always so good. And then Thursday, December 4th, we wrap up with Jake Davis, who I think is also now at Brown, right? He was at the City University of New York. And among other things, he's written on, can enlightenment be traced to specific neural correlates, cognition or behavior? No, and a qualified yes. So those are the upcoming talks. And I hope that you'll be able to join us for those. So, tonight we have Erik Braun. He's from Harvard University. And about 6 years ago, he took a position at the University of Oklahoma. His book, actually, I can't show you his book. Usually we come up here and we show you the guy's books and everything, but these days we're all kind of ebook oriented. So, me too. I now annotate and do everything on my e-pad, my e-book reader. So this is his book, The Birth of Insight, Meditation, Modern Buddhism, and the Burmese Monk Lady Sayadaw. This is a very exciting book. It's very accessible for those of you who are interested in this kind of a topic. It's been lauded in many different forums. I think it was chosen one of the 10 best Buddhist books of 2013. And just recently, it was given an award, the Toshihide Numata Award, for books in Buddhist studies, for those whose book has been the most outstanding contribution to Buddhist studies in the year. And about that, I'm just going to embarrass him by reading something that Robert Sharp wrote about this book. Robert Sharp, some of you maybe were here last year when he gave his talk here at Smith for Peter Gregory's retirement. And he writes, "Erik Braun's superbly researched, elegantly crafted, and eminently accessible book is the most authoritative study to date of Lady Sayadaw and the origins of the modern Buddhist meditation revival in Burma. But its significance goes well beyond the confines of 20th century Burmese history. Lady Sayadaw and his followers laid the foundation for Buddhist modernism. And by the last quarter of the 20th century, their innovative, if sometimes controversial, and some of you might know about those controversies, approach to Buddhist doctrine and practice had spread to the rest of Asia, as well as to Europe, America, and beyond. Braun's account of their achievements should be required reading for anyone interested in the roots of modern insight." But of course, that was in 2013. You know, it's always kind of difficult to invite a speaker to talk about stuff they've already done when you know that they're already moving on to other stuff, but the reason you want to invite them is because you read the stuff that they just published, right? So Erik is already going on to other kinds of things, and so one of them is a volume co-edited with David McMahon, the speaker from last week, called Buddhist Studies and the Scientific Study of Meditation. Very fascinating stuff. We've been having conversations about this since he arrived last evening. And then he has a second book in progress called A Great Awakening, Buddhist Meditation and the Secular Enchantment of American Life. So a very productive scholar and a wonderful fellow. Join me in welcoming Erik to Smith College. For other stuff that we do at Smith and in the five colleges, please sign up on this. Pardon? Put your name on it. We have amazing kinds of people that figure this stuff
out. Well, thanks. Can I just stop now with the introduction? Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. Let me say my thanks to all the folks here who have welcomed me since I arrived, and particularly to Professor Hubbard for arranging this talk and arranging this series, which is really fascinating, and I think actually really unprecedented in terms of the study of the trajectory of forms of the development of mindfulness and insight meditation on a global level, in fact. I'm very glad to be able to add my part, which is going to explore, in a conversational style, I hope to speak fairly extemporaneously, in fact, about the roots of meditation that we have coming, this globalized phenomenon that many people in the room, I'm sure, know quite well, because of course it's quite present here today in the U.S. and particularly in Massachusetts. I entitled the talk, The Queen and the Monk, because as I see it, one way to understand the dynamic that would give birth to what would become a globalized movement of mindfulness meditation or insight meditation. That dynamic is captured in the relationship between these two people. Queen Victoria with her commonly small crown over there, and the monk Lady Sayadaw. Neither, of course, knew the other. The lady may have been aware of Queen Victoria. I seriously thought Queen Victoria was aware of him. But nonetheless, they represent views of the world, ways of living the world, perspectives on the nature of reality. They would come into conflict with each other, and out of which would grow the insight meditation movement that now shows up today. So it really is looking at the roots of the global insight meditation movement in colonial Burma, captured in this relationship. And what I'm really seeking to do is offer a form of what Lewis Mann defines as a form of historical criticism, which is to say, what he puts as the business of putting things back into their context, to see if that makes a difference to how we understand them. And I think it very much does. If we look at where insight meditation specifically comes from, it can most definitely enrich, perhaps in some ways revise our understanding of where meditation originated. At the same time, that can affect how we understand it now, even when it shows up in, say, profoundly secularized forms, such as the Mindful Revolution. People have seen this from last February. And more than that, if it is a revolution, indeed it may well be in terms of how people live their lives and the sort of ethical choices they make and the way their view of reality is shaped. Understanding the roots, putting things back in the context, so to speak, can also shape our understanding of the trajectories for where it's going to go. And so that, perhaps for folks who are actively dealing with mindfulness in their lives, whether it's something they use, something they teach about, perhaps it can offer some insight into its potentialities, into some of its even behaviors, we might say. Okay, so that's a sort of framing of where I'm going with this. So let me explain a little bit about how the project began. It really started in 2005 when I went to Braun, Myanmar to first begin to explore this project. I already had an interest in meditation. I already certainly knew quite well that Burma was a real hotspot for insight practice. The term that's used in Pali, Vipassana, but as I'll refer to it, mindfulness meditation or insight practice, I certainly knew that Burma was a place for that. Burmese themselves understand themselves as sort of, in terms of a self-identity, a self-conceptualization, as really the place for Buddhism from their perspective, but the place for insight meditation as well. But I hadn't yet crystallized the project in terms of the kind of driving question, the driving historical question, say, that was going to push the project through to completion. And my wife and I would go to the shul at dawn. It's traditional, many people perhaps in Europe have been there, and it's traditional to go at dawn as the sun rises. And we're making our way around. This is a photo I took. One thing to note, you can see some people here who are perhaps engaged in meditation, but most people, at least, aren't obviously engaged in meditation. And that just brings up an important point that I think many people know, but in a way it's hard almost to resist a kind of amnesia that can creep over you because of the pervasiveness now of meditation. The fact that most Buddhists don't meditate, never have and don't now. That's even true in Burma, where there is great pride taken in the amount of people who do meditate and the pervasiveness of a variety of practices available. Even there, still, most people don't meditate. But nonetheless, meditation, at least as a concept, is a very, very important part of what Burmese Buddhism is about. The Shwedagon is sort of the apotheosis of representations of Buddhism in Burma. It is probably the most sacred site in Burma. And without question, anything that happens there, anything that appears there, say, an installation, is going to represent the most orthodox and sort of accepted view of what constitutes Buddhism. It's a highly charged space, in other words, and that's true even politically. The movement for independence from the British began at Shwedagon Pagoda, and in 88, Aung San Suu Kyi gave one of her most prominent addresses to a large crowd at Shwedagon Pagoda. So this is a place where when things happen, it's a great moment. So it was very interesting as we made our way around to come upon this map, very prominently displayed on the edge of this pagoda platform. And as I give it in English at the top, it says in red and Burmese at the top of the actual map of inside meditation centers throughout the world. And you can see a little Dharma wheel hovering over roughly Bodh Gaya in India, with red lines radiating out to all these different meditation centers spread throughout the globe. This is actually just meditation. Well, here they are. These are just meditation centers in the tradition of Esengo Inca, who has a center, as probably many people know, out in Shelburne Falls, for instance. Esengo Inca actually died in September of last year, so it's just been about a year now, but his organization is certainly going strong. But although it represents just that one lineage of meditation teaching, he makes the broad point that meditation is now such an accepted part of what Buddhism is, even as a practice, because this, of course, is talking about actual practices going on, that it can show up at the Shwedagon Pagoda as a prominent installation. What's particularly interesting, too, is that the word translated there is Insight Meditation Center, Vipassana Yeta. Yeta is actually a term that means just like center or residence. It has no monastic valence, in other words. So to use that term is to imply that lay people are meditating. And that's a dramatic shift from even conceptions of what meditation would be about in the past. Such that now you can put up that term and sort of go good, and everybody understands that as a normal, natural part of what Buddhism is about. That lay people are meditating all over the world. And this really crystallized the historical project for me. That this kind of mass meditation by both monks and lay people was learned and learned only in the early years of the 20th century, a scale never seen before in Buddhist history. Why then and there? That's the basic question that has driven the project. When you try to answer that question, you're inevitably led back to this figure, Lady Seattle, born in 1846, died in 1923. So my project became one of exploring his life as a means to try to understand why meditation became the prominent feature of Burmese Buddhism. It did, and eventually became a global phenomenon at the present day. Not much work had been done on Lady, in fact. Partly because not much work has been done generally on the time period which Lady lived. Burma is still something of a growth industry for Buddhist studies. I don't know how many of those are, but because of the political situation in the country and whatnot, it's a fairly understudied area, so it's really ripe for picking for anybody out there who is in Buddhist studies. I strongly encourage you to go to Burma's route, but it certainly is true that Lady was little understood. And little looked at from a scholarly perspective. And so that's what I set out to do. Okay, here's just a few more pictures of him since then. Let me give you a little bit of background about him then, as a way to understand, because what we want to do then by looking at some of the experiences he had in the early phase of his life is understand what made the man that he was when, so to speak, he met them. So when queen and monk came together in some sense, and that dynamic produced the Vipassana movements we eventually spread around the world, particularly Mahasi Seyatas, what had constituted the formative period of this man's life? Well, born in the village of Saimkin in 1846 on Christmas Eve, his life was attended and said in his biographies, they shaped in the hagiography, it was attended by many miraculous events, including a rainbow that came out of a clump of bamboo, shot around the village and it went up into the roof of the hut where a lady was being born. So his life is sort of marked by dramatic events, from the biographical perspective anyway, from the time that he really arrived on the scene. One thing this kind of story prefigures, which is certainly the case, is that Lady really from early on, when we have like sort of records of what he was doing, was a quite remarkable figure. Fiercely intelligent man, a really bold guy who did unusual things. So he was really kind of a real distinctive character, that's for sure. Now, Lady, he ordained at the age of 10 as a novice. He left monkhood at the age of 18 to help his family with rice farming for essentially a year, and then went back into the monkhood and fully ordained at the age of 20 and then stayed a monk the rest of his life. So most of his life was as a monk. He distinguished himself tremendously even as a young person. He said he was composing very sophisticated literature, poetry at a young age. He essentially exhausted all of the scholastic and intellectual possibilities in the region in which he was born, which is the Chinwin Valley region of Upper Burma, sort of to the west of Mandalay. So you can see Monyoa up there to the left of Mandalay and the kind of the darker gray area. Lady was from a small village near Monyoa, so that's where he's from. I should say this is a village that it's actually known for producing nice quality rosaries for meditating, but otherwise it's not a distinctive place. It's not known for producing elites. It doesn't possess elite families. In other words, what I'm stressing is that Lady was really a kind of regular fellow from a rice farming family. But he was remarkable. He was well known in his area because of his intellectual abilities. As I say, he essentially tapped out the possibilities in his own area for studying with well-known monks. And so, what do you do at that moment if you've essentially done all you can in the area from which you're from? Well, if you don't have any further ambitions, you can very easily stay a monk in the area in which you were born, stay in the village monastery, say. But if you want to hit the big time, if you want to, you know, if you want to go off to Smith College, what do you have to do? Well, in Burmese counterpart, you got to go to Mount Abe. You have to go to the royal capital, to some of the elite monasteries that are there, and try to win your way into one of those in order to access further learning and move up essentially in the monastic hierarchy. So that's exactly what Lady did. In 1867, at 21 years of age, he settled in Mandalay, and I call this, obviously echoing Dickens, the best of times and the worst, Lady's formative period when he's in Mandalay. The best, because it was a time in which the monkhood had an unprecedented level of support from the king, King Mindong, a tremendous patronage of the Sangha, a really flourishing intellectual community, a really vibrant, disputatious, and from the perspective of monastic work, a really exciting kind of period. At the same time, the worst, though, because Burma was already truncated by the takeover of the British of the bottom half of the country in 1852. The kingdom was very much under threat. That was very much sensed by the Burmese. There was a lot of instability. There was a lot of migration of Burmese from Burmese controlled Upper Burma to the British controlled Lower Burma because of the availability of land for farming. In many ways, it was a very beleaguered state. So there was much that was good and exciting that was happening. There was much dire and threatened. And so in that way, it was a very almost schizophrenic time. And I think that was one of the things that really shaped Lady, because such a schizophrenic time, there was a lot of extreme measures taken that would shape Lady's view of what Buddhism was and what its possibilities were. Now, Lady, when he arrives, he enters a monastery called Thanjiao. Thanjiao was a royally sponsored monastery. The king would actually appoint the abbot of the monastery. So this was a place that was deeply connected to the centers of power, to Mindong and his courtiers. And so when Lady enters this monastery, he really gains a vantage point from which to view sort of close connections between Sangha and state. Lady quickly becomes, it's said, because of his intellectual abilities, recognized by the abbot, who was called the Thanjiao Seado, and becomes a pupil of the abbot and some other prominent monks at the monastery. So Lady really was deeply tied into the apex of the monastic hierarchy in Burma. There were other royally sponsored monasteries, sort of ringing the royal palace complex, but Thanjiao seems to have been the most prominent. So Lady was really at the most prominent place in which to be a monk being trained. And that really put him on a trajectory, in fact, based upon his intellectual abilities to kind of go, you know, the sky was the limit in essence for his movement up in the monastic hierarchy when he entered this place because of these connections that he formed and the learning that he needed to have. But as I say, he certainly saw from the viewpoint of being able to see how Sangha and state were connected, how important even monastic learning was to figures at the court, including the king, who was deeply interested in learning and supporting Buddhist learning, and using that learning as a way to make sense out of what would be learned from the West as well. So what's important to understand here is then that Buddhist learning was not just for the purposes, say, of seeking awakening, so that was certainly that was part of it, but it was understood as a means to cope with the challenges that the state faced. And so Lady is learning a valuable lesson in his sort of formative years as a young monk, that what he does, the learning he promotes and he produces and he teaches and he spreads, has an integral role to play in the health of society. That's one very important feature. I might note too that Mindong himself was said to have been quite interested in meditation. And often scholars will talk about the fact that Mindong may have been the first model of a lay person, or the possibility of a lay person meditating. That may well be true, though Lady never says this, that that's the case. And Mindong's meditation was not at all like the kind of mindfulness we know now. Actually, it's not talked about much, though it's said that he would give himself over to mindfulness, like when he went to the bathroom. This is what the texts say. So, you know, it said because kings are so busy, he didn't have time otherwise. So when you go to the bathroom, you be mindful. Take it where you can get it, I guess. And at the same time, he said he would keep toothpicks made out of human bones. He would keep a skeleton at the court to observe, to remind himself of death. These are all very traditional modes of practice. But not much like practices that are typically followed these days, and certainly not in the West. So he doesn't seem to have served as an actual specific exemplar of possibilities and techniques of practice. But he may well have signaled the possibility generally of the practice. And it will become the case that the king as a symbolic figure occupies a central role in how Lady would articulate the possibility of practice for everyday folks in the world. Lady was also very close with a man named Polheim, a man who's crying out for a book and study from somebody. A fascinating figure. He was banned 3 times from the court because of his outspoken ways. Actually, it's said that he told Mendon that he was helping to bring the kingdom down by having too much sex. Mendon had a number of wives. This is not something you say to Burmese kings. Mendon is said to have been so angry that he grabbed a spear off the wall, a spear that had actually been used to kill Polheim's father, and he lifted it up to stab Polheim in the chest. The story is told to give an idea of Polheim's personality. It said that Polheim looked at the king and the spear and took his shirt, ripped it open, and stuck his chest out and said, "Please execute me, Your Majesty." This is not a guy who was afraid of anything. He got banned for saying that, for telling him he was having sex. He got banned by Mendon again for telling him that alcohol was okay to drink, and he got banned a third time by the subsequent king, Bibaw, for suggesting a sort of constitutional monarchy. So a really fascinating figure. But he was really an in-your-face, no-holds-barred, tell-it-like-it-is kind of guy. Not only in his personality when you meet with people, but in his writing. And Lady actually says, in one source, he says, "I write the way I do, thanks to Polheim." So he seems to have taken Polheim as a sort of model for a literary production. And what's notable about that is that Polheim is famous not only for being very blunt, but also for being very simple in his style. And reaching out to lay people through that simplicity and just through his effort to write books specifically for a wider audience. And that's what Lady becomes known for as well. That's one aspect, anyway, of his fame. The books Lady writes are understood to be simple, clear, and direct, and aimed specifically at lay people. Polheim, too, is distinctive because he was put in charge, not banned, for helping to make sense out of Western learning for the court. And so as somebody who taught Lady, he was somebody who gave him direct access to a sense of what Western learning was and how one might jive it with Burmese Buddhist thought. So Polheim actually also had an interest in meditation. He wrote a book called The Meditation on the Body, Kriyanupasana. And in that book, Polheim had actually had an Italian anatomy textbook translated from the Italian to Burmese. He actually takes the Italian anatomy textbook and he correlates its descriptions of particular parts of the body to specific parts of the Abhidhamma. And so he will say, like, well, the anatomy textbook says the eye is structured like this. There's an orb with this fine mesh of nerves that travel to this central artery, to this place. And say, now the Abhidhamma says this. And this, there's the sensitive material, the sada rupas that meet the sensory object. And he would correlate these two to one another. In essence, to teach the lesson that Burmese Buddhism, what it has to say about the nature of the world, and Western scientific learning, what it has to say about the world, are not only commensurate but equal, but in fact, equal in some sense that they're both speaking to the same reality, but the Burmese version, the Buddhist version, that is to say, is the more accurate. Because, of course, it leads to awakening. It doesn't simply describe the world, but it proscribes something to do with that information in order to free yourself. So this surely was, most definitely was, a profound influence on Lady as well. Okay. So Lady's life, Don John, is really a story of success. Certainly his biography is presented that way. He moved up the hierarchy. He was promoted to become a monastic teacher and eventually the head monastic teacher of Don John. He certainly seen the Sangha and stated that he joined in karmic hell. This is a picture of him reciting a text from the Abhidhamma. What's important to keep in mind about all this learning as another factor is that when it comes to learning, when it comes to using information to make sense out of the world, the preeminent source for that, in terms of Buddhist sources, is the Abhidhamma. And Burmese, still today, pride themselves on their specialization, so to speak, in the Abhidhamma. They take great pride in that. They celebrate it as the preeminent teaching of the Buddha and their own efforts to preserve that that most rarefied and complex and sophisticated teaching. And back then, certainly, the Abhidhamma was already sort of key means to prestige and elite status in the monastic hierarchy. And Lady excelled at it, without a doubt. Okay. There he is teaching. These are paintings actually from Lady's monastery up near Mont-Blanc. You see my camera flash, it's obviously on some of these. After Mendong comes King Dibala, the kingdom begins to really become unstable. Essentially, Dibala's extent of control really shrunk to nothing but the palace compound in which he lived. Dacoits or brigands were sort of rampant in the countryside. Fires break out. The kingdom becomes greatly impoverished and essentially only exacerbates the problem of Dibala. Starts a lottery that impoverishes a lot of people. Great fires break out, and one of them burns down Thanjau, so in 1883. Now, this is before the arrival of the British, but certainly these problems were, in some sense, if not fomented, they were certainly catalyzed by the instability created by the rule of the British to the south. But at this time, the British weren't yet there. But the Lady's monastery burns down and he faces mission. He certainly could have stayed in Ronda. That seems, you know, unquestionable. But instead he chooses to head back to his natal area, back to the village of Sain Kien. He sort of moves around a little bit for about a year, but then enters into the jungle and sets up his own monastery called the Lady Forest Monastery. And that's actually where he gets his name, Lady Seagal. Before that he was actually known as Nyana Dajin, the banner of wisdom. But from that time, he moves into the jungle, into the forest of Lady. He becomes the Lady Seada, and it's at that time that he begins to meditate. So up until this time, there's no record that he was meditating at all. There's no record that there was really practically any meditation going on in Mandalay. Although Ubo Line, for instance, was quite interested in meditation as an intellectual topic and as a way to kind of bridge the gap between Western and Burmese learning, there's no indication that he meditated either, and certainly he didn't promote it as a necessity for lay people on a widespread basis. That certainly was not happening. It's really only once Lady kind of takes off from the jungle, after he loses his monastery and everything he owns, including much of the intellectual work he'd been doing, that he really takes on the burden of practice and begins to teach it. So, clearly already in Lady's life, he's not yet promoting it for other people. He's still a relatively unknown monk at this moment. He's prominent in the monastic hierarchy, but he's not yet a national figure. His turn to practice is connected to political events, to social instability, to whatnot. He must leave his home because of the fire, and then he goes off into the jungle in this kind of renunciation society. Now, why? Because it seems clear that all of these events that are signaling this instability were conveying a message to Lady that the world was nearing its end. And the sasana was coming, potentially coming to a close. The sasana being defined as the kind of complex of monastic institutions and Buddhist learning together. In a poem that Lady wrote at this time, he said, we are living near the end of the sasana. So he put it directly into words. So then practice becomes, in some sense, a coping mechanism for that grave situation in which Buddhism is disappearing from the world. Okay. Just a few years later, in 1885, the British arrived, and that's actually a picture of them arriving. As you can see by this point, this is arriving in Mandalay. It wasn't a particularly warlike scene. They'd fought some battles as they'd come up the Ayawadi River, but by this time they sort of just arrived and are greeted by people. It's a really quite critical moment. It's this disruptive moment from the pre-colonial to the colonial. And one of the interesting things about Lady, and that makes him a quite interesting figure to study, is that his life almost perfectly straddles that divide between pre-colonial and colonial period. So when you're looking at the origination of the birth of the insight meditation, you are looking at something that emerges initially from a figure who partakes of the pre-colonial moment, the royal dynastic moment, and the colonial period. And so it brings both of those influences into his activities. This is valuable as a way to, well, as I put it here, to unpack what really counts in the modern form of Theravada Buddhism. So one of the larger theoretical interests I have, besides the historical question that was driving this, is how this might change what we understand about modern Buddhism. You know, there's a kind of tendency in Buddhist studies, at least in the past, this is definitely changing through folks' work, to see colonialism as a moment where there's a radical break that sort of signals a new kind of moment for analysis from a sort of ground zero, so to speak. Everything's been broken down and we'll now start again. It's not that people thought that the figures who were working at this time couldn't remember their past, but that in some sense everything they do is reconfigured by that radical disruption that colonialism creates. My argument would be that this is decidedly not the case, that everything I just sketched for you in terms of the figures that Leahy knew, the places he lived, the events that happened, were an important part of why he would promote this form of meditation in the way he did. Okay. There's that map that we saw a little earlier. We've seen these kind of stepped kind of moments of takeover by the British of the whole of the country. Okay. Now, what this produced in Leahy, this takeover, was only an exacerbation of the feeling he had since his monastery had burned down in 1883, and that's a sense of tremendous anxiety. So this is something that Leahy said himself. He emphasizes the idea that the sasana, extreme bodily and intellectual, is diminishing the great traditions of learning, which is the root of the great tradition of practice and the great tradition of realization. So note the importance of learning here. It's not exactly shocking, but it's interesting to see the prominence in which Leahy puts us at this moment of what is perceived as terrible colonial threat as the country is taken over by non-Buddhist foreigners. And so he says only when the sasana, the tradition of learning, is established and the other two sasanas also be established. So there's a sense in which if we're going to protect Buddhism for as long as we can, maybe even near the end of the sasana, but if we're going to keep it around for as long as we can, the linchpin is going to be learning. And therefore the emphasis that Leahy is going to put on learning is tremendous, because that's where Buddhism is going to live or die. It's better to keep it around on that basis. All right, so here's where we meet. So at this time when the British arrive, this expresses the policy of the British to Burmese Buddhism from a political perspective. It's incredibly Victorian sentence. We do strictly charge and enjoy all those who may be in authority under us, that they abstain from all interference with the religious belief or worship of any of our subjects on pain of our highest displeasure. I originally had this sentence in the article I wrote for Tricycle, and the editors were like, "Oh, we can't have this." The funny thing is when I show this to students, for instance, their kind of immediate gut reaction, if I don't preface it in any way, is, this is pretty darn enlightening. This is pretty great. Let them be. Let them do what they want. Don't force yourself on them. Let the people have their religious freedom. I think particularly from an American perspective, this sounds like a separation of church and state in some way, and therefore a kind of worthy policy in terms of dealing with the people that you rule. Of course, you've subjugated colonially, but at least you're giving them this. And of course, as you probably know, this is from the Proclamation of 1858 that was made in response to the Sepoy Rebellion, as a way to try to ensure there wasn't that kind of violent outbreak again. But here's where it's really revealed the kind of conflict this kind of policy creates, a radically different kind of view of reality and the nature of the relationship between Sangha and state from what one might assume from, say, a Western perspective. Because, I'll leave it at this, because from the Burmese perspective, that kind of attitude is not a sort of benign neglect, but an active insult and injury to the Burmese Buddhist tradition. From the Burmese perspective, Buddhism is something that will only survive and flourish and continue if it has direct support, preeminently from the king, and therefore one might say by extension from the political entity that's present, so it would be the British and once they've taken over. So worried by where the Burmese Buddha said, the head of the monks in Burma called the Thathnabai, that position had remained empty when the British took over. And the monks actually went to the British and told them, if you will so officially designate one of these monks that we put before you as the head of all monks in Burma, as the Thathnabai, we will publicly proclaim our allegiance to you as the government. So we'll actually actively give you our support to rule us. And still the British wouldn't do it. But it goes to show that if they were willing to do that, they were willing to go to what they would call the Kalas, which is a rather not nice term for foreigners, and offer their support in exchange for this. It shows how important it was that they have governmental support, but it was not to be. They were not to receive it. Eventually, the British sort of kind of recognized who the monks could finally agree on as the Thought and Abide. That lacked the kind of force of a direct recognition of a figure, and wasn't. And the position essentially fell into desuetude and eventually disappeared. Well, beyond this fact that the British were not willing to actually actively support Buddhism, they, of course, in many ways, actively supported Christianity. They gave tacit support to Christian schools, if not overt support, in fact. They promoted the sale of intoxicants for their own profit. They also disrupted society through the sudden introduction of print culture, which wasn't seen as a bad thing necessarily, but was another force of destabilization. At the same time, because of the lack of the support from the government, which had been a major source of support for many monks, there was a perceived shrinking of the Sangha. All of these things came together to produce the tremendous anxiety that was seen as connected to the loss of the king and the arrival of this foreign rule. So what do you do in those circumstances? Well, this is where a lady reacts and comes to formulate essentially a program to protect Buddhism in this age of anxiety, so to speak, that really empowers the lady and radically changes their position in Burmese society. He does this through three modes that I have up here, and I have a little quote from each of this sort of exemplified, either from lady or from two British officials. He engages in he actually crisscrosses the entire country. Essentially, over the rest of his life, he stays in a range retreat 2 years in a row in one place, and otherwise, essentially for the rest of his life until his very old age, he's constantly on the move, preaching doctrine in different places. He's also organizing, so he's forming lay people into groups under their own steam. So he would organize them around, say, study of doctrine that he had just preached about, for instance. But then he would put it under the control of the lay people themselves. So this is a radical form of empowerment, where the lay people begin to understand themselves as responsible for their own spiritual development, for their own practice. At the same time, he's writing a tremendous number of books. Here's all his books, carved in stone in his monastery. He was an extremely prolific man. It's actually said he was like a surgeon. He would have a young monk next to him who would have a big box of pencils, and he would write until it went down to a little nub, and then he wrote a pencil. And he'd have one in his hand, and he'd just keep on going. And it said he wrote so much in poor lighting that that's why he went blind towards the last couple of years of his life. He strained so much. As you can see, the Burmese is not large on these tombstone-looking monuments. So it was this incredible amount that he produced. All of it in the style of Rupo Lai, direct, or pretty much all of it. Direct, clear, simple, free of many of the kind of poetic redundancies and poly terminology and whatnot that typically would have made it off-putting, if not incomprehensible to most people, including monks. All of that is eschewed in favor of this rather simple style. And this, of course, really spread the word, because print culture made it possible to get these kind of teachings out at a level that they had never been before, even beyond, say, the preaching. All of it was modeled, as I have here, on the king. So here's where I said that the symbol of the king even didn't offer, say, specific inspiration. He offered kind of general inspiration. What Lady actually says, I have a quote in my book, is that if you've got a king, that's the guy who ought to be the sort of central source of support for the Sangha. But in an age in which the king is gone, it's the responsibility of all of us, we people of Myanmar, that's the term he used, both monastic and lay, to take charge of the sasana to ensure it flourishes for as long as possible. So he took the reins, put them into the hands of lay people. And this was a form of empowerment. On the basis of learning, this is not yet about meditation, but that would really make it possible for lay people to also collectively engage in meditative practice that would end up spreading on a mass basis. Okay, so it's particularly Abhidhamma, and it's said he taught it like falling rain. So it's a very well-known historian in Burma named Uko Le, who's also a very well-known meditator, said it's typically seen that the Abhidhamma was too difficult for lay people, not taught to them. But the lady said, no, the Abhidhamma is one essential element of his teachings and should be available. And so that's just what he did. He spread it widely in his preaching, in his prints, among many other topics, but the Abhidhamma is really the kind of keynote that he keeps returning to. Now, meditation actually follows from that learning in close connection to it, and particularly from Abhidhamma learning. And so this is just a quote, I won't read this whole thing to you, but he basically tells people, look, you're going to die, and you're going to be, you know, if you don't practice, you know, people say, well, I don't want to practice until I'm sure I'm going to awaken. Maybe I'll wait until Mateo comes along. But, you know, to do that, you're going to go to hell for 100,000 years, maybe 100 million, who knows. But if you were to practice now, you might be able to, you know, free yourself, or at least lessen the amount of time you suffer. So in other words, to use the Burmese expression in English, spin cotton while the moon is bright. This is how they put make hay while the sun shines. And that's actually a term he uses. Meditate now, when you have this learning, before the substance disappears, so that you won't end up having to wait a very long time before you can do it again. And so he begins to teach meditation as well as learning. Some of this, I should say, is driven, too, by the interest of lay people themselves. So it's not like they just sat there and learned until they told them something. They were actively asking him for things, including that he teach them meditation. And so he did just that. And he taught breath meditation, and wrote works on meditation like the Anapanasati and many others, conjoining them because learning could segue naturally into practice. And this is something that Lady said about the use of the Abhidhamma in practice. This is actually something he says in the Manual of Factors of Awakening before the body. That at least one should strive just to realize the division into four parts of one's body, the four great elements of earth, water, fire, and wind. Although one does not have any skill in any other part of the Abhidhamma, if one masters the four elements, one gains the seeds of wisdom which are very difficult to acquire. So, Abhidhamma was a sort of basis for the possibility of practice. And one of my arguments is, this is the 24 conditional relations of the Katana and the Abhidhamma here at the top of the monastery gate. Abhidhamma really makes possible practice and sort of forms the, what one might say is a genetic basis for practice in Burma. And with one distinctive feature of Burmese culture, I think it makes possible a kind of portable practice that lay people can take up. Here's an example of a recent monk, Titipuseo, still very much around and active, that really expresses the conjunction of Vipassana and Abhidhamma. You don't have to wait, you don't have to master the Abhidhamma before you practice, but the study of the Abhidhamma and the Vipassana meditation remain one and the same thing. So there's an idea that these things are very closely conjoined. But how do you actually make it simple so that lay people can do it? They can't necessarily, as is classically suggested, engage in deep, deep concentrated states such as the jhanas. Take a tremendous amount of effort and removal from the world before they begin practicing. They gotta go to work in the morning. They gotta raise kids, you gotta do all these things. One way is to draw upon the classical texts to promote inertia and meditation on the basis of what's called momentary concentration, kamya samadhi. This is the idea that you can begin your vipassana or insight practice without any sort of softening up or preparation of your mind through concentrated practice. Some concentration will follow from momentary concentration, but essentially you can begin inside practice immediately. And he was one of the first teachers in the modern era to offer this approach of what's called pure or mere inside practice, sukha vipassana, sometimes also called dry practice, sukha vipassana. What's distinctive about this is something that's present in the classical texts, like Buddha Ghosts and Sutta Mother. But what's distinctive is that he doesn't only offer it as a preferential option, but as a sort of default practice that you would engage in. And of course, he does it on a widespread basis through so many works that he spreads and through all the preaching that he does. He particularly focuses on the four elements, which is not something that you find so distinctive about, say, many of the practices you see nowadays in the West, where the focus is principally on breath. For him, that was really kind of a distinctive feature. That is still something you see if anyone's familiar with the teachings of S.N. Goenka or some of those folks. They do focus still on sort of meditation using the experience of the elements. It's all primed by studying the Abhidhamma. So what I say is that the lever, in essence, to make the monastic as lay, excuse me, the layperson's name, he says, a monk in the world, even though a layperson, and he's ripping off of a statement from Buddha in the Dhammapada. The lever is the Abhidhamma, because he uses that distinctive focus on the Abhidhamma as a way to prepare lay people through a certain kind of study that presents meditation as sensible on the basis of that study. And it's possible for a large group of people because they've been collectivized now in their own esteem, and they've been prepared to study. And the argument is made for the plausibility of this in the basis of the model of the king. And that's what it was. Plus, once you add in the ability to obviate the necessity of extended calming practices, which are good practices where you enter into these deep altered states of absorption like the jhanas, well, then you make it all the more accessible and portable, as I say here, to any setting or situation. What I have here is a way of talking about the contrast this reveals in the lady's approach to this practice from the Western perspective. So here's a poem from Lane. This is the one where he says that we're living there in the sasana, versus a poem from Matthew Arnold. You know, the idea of modernity, a classical idea, I'm taking this from Charles Taylor, who uses this same poem. The idea of modernity in, from a Western perspective is often the retreat of faith, right? The loss of belief, to leave the naked shingles of the world kind of bare. It's an ideal idea of what Charles Taylor calls a subtraction story. You kind of lose everything, and you're left with a kind of empty space, and that empty space is perhaps sad and secular. On the other hand, that of course is not necessarily the case about what secularity is really like, but that reveals a kind of sensibility around what modernity constitutes in terms of religion. For Lady, that is not at all the case. When he's forming this modern vision of practice and activity in the world in response to colonialism and the worry about the loss of Buddhism, it is very much on the basis of a kind of rich understanding created in his formative era prior to the arrival of the British. Very rich understanding of the world in Buddhist terms. So what you can say is that, in essence, it's a world, for the modern world, to really make sense on a Buddhist basis. That Buddhism doesn't so much fit modern life, which is an argument we often hear about what Buddhist modernism is. It's a way in which to make Buddhism sort of scientific and to fit the kind of the rationale of modernity. But from Lady's perspective, really modern life fits Buddhism. Buddhism doesn't fit modern life. He brings that into his vision of what a modern form of practice and Buddhist life would be like. And that's revealed in a poem like this. I'm going to pass over this pretty quickly, some of this theoretical stuff. But essentially what I'm trying to do here is articulate on a theoretical basis how we can understand the bringing in of a kind of formative period that's pre-colonial with that colonial moment and the arrival of the British. And what I'm going to argue is that what we essentially see in Lady's life as a form of the habit is dependence, where Lady is shaped and constrained by the in terms of possibilities for practice and innovation on the basis of the kind of worldview that he's already in, the situated freedom he has, but he certainly has agency within that. So Lady wasn't entirely free to do whatever he wanted, but he certainly wasn't utterly constrained by the colonial moment in terms of what he was going to do. So all this counteracts what I was talking about earlier, a kind of sea change model where you see colonialism as that moment where all the possibilities for Buddhist modernism, for Buddhist innovation must begin from ground zero, so to speak, with the colonial, the disruptive arrival of colonialism. And these are just a few quotes from Marx and from Engels, of course, two guys who are in close relationship with one another, kind of puts it in this starkest form, the idea that everything begins at that what I think Lady's life shows is that Engels was essentially dead wrong, that tradition is not a kind of force of inertia in the world, but in fact, tradition is a source of agency. So, you know, if tradition is not a kind of, I think it's a great retarding force, it's not some sort of block to change and innovation, but it's the very basis on which change and innovation can take place. And that's certainly true of Lady, who draws on the Abhidhamma, who draws on his formative period in Mandalay as the basis for the innovations he would make. And so that's one way in which we can kind of give back agency to figures at this time and see, well, I think, more richly the logic of the choices they make in terms of the changes they make in Buddhism. So essentially what we do on the basis of being shaped by our situation but having agency is we improvise. And that's what I'm saying, Lady did. So it's an argument for a certain sense of vision. Plus, we have to add in the fact that it was just probably a genius. You know, you can't ever leave out that factor, right? Wendy Gunger has a great line in her book, The Hindu, where she says, people are not just the product of the zeitgeist. Shakespeare isn't just an Elizabethan writer. You know, he's Shakespeare. In the same way, maybe he's clearly just a really distinct figure. We don't want to leave that out either. He was just a really talented and unusual fellow. Okay, he died in 1923. Given a lax of the verb by a visiting Thai monk to try to help him out, he didn't help. The Thai monk apparently fled in terror, but you know it wasn't intentional. But that was in 23 when he had gone online for a few years. He said he devoted the last years of his life to meditation. But change, of course, continues and affects a lineage. I don't want to spend too much time and weary you with some of the further effects, but maybe I'll just pass it rather quickly. Some of the changes that develop, some of the things that stay the same as well. What I noticed, the Bodhidharma Pagoda is also in Yangon. I don't know if it's in there. It's a quite remarkable pagoda as well. What's really interesting is there's a statue, here it is, on those grounds of the Bodhidharma Pagoda. And, you know, you don't typically see that mudra, where the Buddha has both hands up like that. And when you look at it closely, it's quite revealing because he has words raising on his hands. On the left it says Ati, on his right it says Ati, and on his left it says Ati. So Ati can in Burmese mean learning. Ati means sati, mindfulness. So the Buddha comes to have a message of learning and mindfulness, which is exactly what maybe was sort of promoting in his presentation of the possibility of practice and his understanding of what Burmese would be. This is sort of the central message of the Buddha is spread. And it's really distinctive that it would be, you know, this sort of message of the importance of learning and mindfulness is kind of two hallmarks of what Buddhist practice would be about. It's not at all considered an unorthodox statue. So far as I'm aware, it receives a whole bunch of devotion. You can see the folks around here. So it's sort of just a widely accepted kind of vision of what the Buddha's message would be. It was donated by, as I say up there, by a really well-known film actor who was becoming a monk, John Hayne, and he sort of had this particular statue built. Okay. Lady is also distinctive because not only does he, he not only teaches monks and he teaches lay people generally, but he actually establishes a layman, Seiya Tenchi, as a meditation teacher. And still, really today, the only prominent meditation lineage that I'm aware of anyway that's headed by lay people is this lineage that flows from Seiya Tenchi. From it comes, the way the Sudha is kind of inserted into the lineage kind of laterally as another teacher, but it really goes from Seiya Tenchi to Uba Khin. And from Uba Khin to Damyan Khwin, Seiya Maji, and also to Essen Guin. I should put now, there's a debate on the end of that I from that line, 2013. His practice sort of spreads through them. Really, even as it goes on, radically simplified even further, so that the technique comes to be promoted without such an emphasis on learning, and it's widely spread on a kind of standardized basis through technology, through particular lectures and whatnot. Mahasi Seyala, there are some who say, perhaps Professor Yor can speak about this when she comes in, because I know that she's had some informants tell her this, that Mahasi did study under a Seyada who studied with Lady. But most of the sources suggest that Mahasi was really in a kind of parallel tradition of teaching, not directly in the lineage of Lady. But even Mahasi's teacher, the Ningun Seyada, that everyone acknowledges the Ningun Seyada as Mahasi's teacher, he himself is a junior by decades to Lady. So it's very hard to believe that he would have been deeply influenced by Lady's teachings and Lady's prominence. The Mahasi Seyada, of course, teaches a notion of teaches a technique of noting, that really is depends upon a kind of kanika samadhi. That is the method that ends up coming if we jump to the West to these figures who we all know, Jacqueline Schwartz, Joseph Goldstein, Jack Ornfield, and Sharon Salzberg, who established the Insight Meditation Society. They actually were deeply influenced directly by the lineage of Lady through Essen Goenka, at the same time they had all practiced it under the Mahasi lineage, either with Mahasi or with Mindra and some other people who were in the Mahasi lineage. So they sort of brought these together and taught these together, but with key, of course, transformations, including the sort of radical secularization and psychologization of practice, that would remove the kind of cosmological framework from the practice, and sort of teaching on the basis purely of the technique. For this, you might say, for ends in this life, not for everybody, of course. People certainly would still have traditional Buddhist goals, including say, awakening. But practice wasn't framed within this cosmological context in the same way it had been for maybe some of the Burmese teachers. So we end up with the possibility, not the exclusive possibility, but certainly the possibility of mindfulness coming to be understood in the psychological sense as we have it here, as a kind of bare aware, bare attention, a kind of a non-elaborative, non-judgment, mental presence, sense of awareness, that is simply a sort of accepting of reality as it is. And that, of course, will represent a profound innovation in the tradition, this kind of development of mindfulness in these terms. I'm going to skip that and get right to this. What's really interesting is we have a quote from Leahy where he says, "How fearful, sickening, and abhorrent is the state of an ordinary person, putujana." You go from that to a sort of celebration of life, mindful eating, raising your mindful child, and even mindful sex. This, I can't imagine what Leahy would think, you know, if he saw this book. Really a radical kind of divergence from his sort of perspective. But one that flows from the original changes that he made on the basis of a kind of sense of anxiety that he and his fellow Burmese faced at that moment when he began to innovate back in the early 20th century, at a very late 19th, early 20th century. So radical change at the same time, but we do have some continuities in the sense of the possibility of lay practice and its appropriateness for lay people living regular lives. Well, I think I'll stop there, and I'm happy to kind of go on. I did, since I've taken just a little under an hour, maybe about 15 minutes, I don't want to go on too long, I'd be happy to discuss if people are interested in some of the new movements that have cropped up, including the rise, or you might say the, not so much the resurgence, but the development recently of an interest once again in jhana meditation, the possibility of these deep concentrated states. This is promoted, for instance, by this well-known monk Tao, so shows up in works like these, and Beyond Mindfulness and Shadow Catholic Buddhism, and even many other sources as well. But I'll leave it there for now, and I'm happy to answer the questions you have. Thank you very much.
I've learned from Jay Garfield, let's see if I can just give you something that can help me, Connie can help me if I go like this. So, hand up means a new question. A finger up means a follow-up to a question. Fingers take precedent over hands. Follow-ups take hands. Follow-ups take precedent over new minds. And students have precedent over everybody. So, yeah, it was complicated. Some Australian thing, Jay, I don't know. So, questions, students out there?
Brought up at the end of Hama Saida and spoofed sort of concern with jhana, sort of this debate, jhana and vipassana. And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about how the Burmese, in conversation with other Southeast Asian, you know, Thai or tradition, how you see the Burmese really trying to defend their own sort of authority in the modern meditation movement through this conversation about concentration versus anxiety.
Right. Well, it's interesting because, I mean, it depends on the actors, groups that one is talking about. In some ways, like when it comes to the situation with the jhanas in Burma, it was very much seen that, for instance, that the Pao said when he was first becoming sort of widely known in Burma, this teaching was quite controversial. One thing to keep in mind is that in the kind of Burmese context and sort of birth, the Burmese Buddhist world, Samatha practices, calming practices that are associated with well, there are the practices that include the jhanas are also associated with worldly power, with the collection of supernatural abilities of great strength. And they're also, in that sense, seen as worldly and even kind of threading into the worldly order. You might use them for nefarious ends, right? So to this degree, jhana practices are associated with a class of practitioners who have a kind of, well, very multivalent position, let's say, called waitsa. And waitsa, which is actually the Burmese pronunciation of the word vidya, knowledge, these are understood as sorcerers or wizards who use their power often to protect Buddhism, but can also use it for, say, black magic. They typically these days, a friend of mine who's really specialized in the study of the waitsa told me that they now like to be called wizards ever since the Lord of the Rings came out. They really like that term. But because of this association with these kind of powers that can be politically unstable, the military junta was not fond of Paulo Coelho's teachings and, in fact, suppressed them, so they couldn't be published and whatnot. At the same time, because there had been a kind of dominant sense of Burmese Buddhism as defined by Vipassana and insight practice, you know, there was a sort of a sense, too, of protecting that kind of vision of what the meditation was about, particularly the Mahasa Sayadaw, who had been officially promoted, particularly by the early government of Wu Nu, but certainly widely celebrated later on by military rulers. I haven't had the impression that there's been a sense that there's been a lot of competition that somehow is threatening Burmese prominence in terms of meditation, say from other quarters. But it's a really good question about how these various people relate. Of course, Thai forest traditions do have a much stronger tradition of deep concentrated practice, and folks like Thanissaro Bhikkhu and such figures as in the West and many others as well, Ajahn Lee, Ajahn Mun originally, who started that lineage, they really stressed the importance of concentrated practice. So, in the American scene, these influences are kind of coming together, but so far I don't see that there's been a sense then that they're jockeying for position of one another, kind of trying to push themselves out of the way. They've sort of been melded and blended together, in fact, without too much consternation. Though there remains tensions between insight camps and jhana camps. We were actually talking about this earlier. That sort of simmer. I don't know if they ever come to a full boil or anything, but they're definitely there. Yes?
Can you just go for a minute and explain how
I pass over it very quickly. It's essentially after the lady has them sort of fully conjoined, intends to present them as a kind of total package. And it's really in his followers, particularly, I would argue, in the teaching of a sort of grandson in his lineage. So Ubakin is the one I go back. There's Ubakin. So we have Seotechi, of which plenty is known on a kind of anecdotal basis and an oral basis within these traditions, but he didn't leave a lot of writings behind. It's hard to say definitively, but it's certainly the case that we get to Ubakin, who cared very much about doctrinal learning, but did simplify the technique in many ways, streamlined it. He was particularly interested in teaching Westerners, and so kind of offered another kind of streamlined, standardized basis to them. It was only accentuated by Essing Gawinka, who goes on to say that he's not even teaching Buddhism. He's just teaching the Dhamma, which happens to have been promulgated by Buddha, but it's not an ism such as Buddhism. So he has this sort of very strong sense of the prominence of the technique rather than just kind of learning. Yet they all maintain, I would argue, although they begin to downplay like the upfront study of meditation, meditative theory and Abhidhamma, they all maintain a strongly kind of Abhidhamma framework that, as you go deeper into their teachings, begins to emerge actually quite clearly. In terms of the kalapas, these various subatomic particles, in terms of the understanding of moments of time of the mind, all sorts of things. And so they never lose that emphasis. Even today, as in the tradition, though I think people, perhaps people who are within the tradition, can say more I think once we get to Westerners, there's much more variability in how important this, this sort of theoretical learning is.
It's a follow-up. Can you tell us a little bit about the history of why Abhidhamma was so central in Burma prior to the 19th century? Right. How did it come to be the core, the centerpiece of Buddhist learning today?
Well, I don't have an utterly definitive answer for you. You know, there's a story that's told that there was a ship at sea. I'll begin with this, but I have more specific stories. And the ship founders and breaks apart, and it contains the Tipitaka within this. And the Tipitaka itself breaks apart into its baskets at sea. And this must be the Bay of Bengal, because what happens is the Sutta floats to Sri Lanka, the Vinaya floats to Thailand, and the Abhidhamma washes up on the shores of Burma. Have you heard of this before? I don't think the Sri Lankans particularly feel like they've got to be specialists in the suttas and the Thais, the Vinaya, but the Burmese, I certainly tell the story. And it does speak to a certain kind of popularity of the Abhidhamma. If you see the problem that's beginning to really grow in the 17th century. And there's an emergence at that time of these handbooks called Ayyappal, that are these kind of primers, these kind of sort of cheat sheets for doctrinal learning. And there's a distinctive part of the Burmese tradition at that time. And it's at that time that you see the kind of efflorescence of Abhidhamma primers for study. You can actually look at Pagan inscriptions and see like a kind of a great patronage of the copying of the Abhidhamma texts and whatnot, but not necessarily so distinctive that it would be something different from any other culture or even more distinctive than, say, the Vinaya or the Sutta. But you do get these primers developing. You get monks being recognized as specialists in memorization methods for the learning of the Abhidhamma. So it seems like at a certain moment in perhaps the 17th, 18th century, early 18th, the learning becomes to be accepted. But why exactly at that moment, I don't know. There is a sort of celebration of the learning of the Abhidhamma in Sri Lanka. There are certain sources that suggest that the monks were rewarded the most for learning the Abhidhamma versus the other aspects of the Tipitaka. And one theory could be that the monks who traveled to Sri Lanka brought back, you know, along with lineages, of course, that sort of preeminence of the Abhidhamma. But that's just a supposition on my part. I don't have any sort of hard and fast information that would support that. It's just a sort of idea. But we do see kind of early on that those sort of primers emerging. And really from then on, is a sort of celebration. Yes?
I was wondering, sort of like what the specific correlation between Abhidhamma and the four great elements were, like specifically why those four elements is really special?
Well, really special because they're fairly immediately accessible. So earth is a quality of solidity and cohesion, so you can feel it right now on the seat that you're sitting on. Fire is a quality of hot and cold temperature that you might be able to sense right now. And wind is a kind of movement that even if you're feeling like, I don't know, your stomach gurgling or like tingling in your hands or whatever you're feeling. Cohesion, water, is, they say, is not so easy to feel. But the others, really, it isn't immediately accessible. But the others are. So that's one reason. But its connection to the Abhidhamma is in the fact that it is an integral part of the 28 elements of materiality in the Abhidhamma system. So, you know, within this Abhidhamma system, there's only a finite number of truly real entities. And of those entities, some are material and some are mental. And so the earth, wind, fire, water, and air are what are called the Mahabhutanis, the four great primary elements from which other elements sort of depend. And so for that, so you're getting to the core of reality, for one thing, you feel, and they're immediately accessible. And so to that degree, they're a very effective way from one's perspective to go in terms of your meditation.
Other questions?
There might be another follow-up.
Western or tribal religious ideas that were circulating more about the time of, end times, so sort of in the century of millenarianism. If he was able to more sort of just traditional, this is a sign.
Well, as far as I'm aware, I mean, he was schooled in this very traditional fashion. He did become quite aware of the theories of the world and such, but not until really later in his life. And of course, his millennial movements arise in Burma throughout its history. But they're on the basis of a kind of Buddhist cosmological view. I mean, there's many interesting variations on that, but they all tend to be rooted in Buddhist context, in Buddhist learning and music of the world, and not so much in traditions that come from the outside.
Actually, I have a
question.
Yeah. Bringing that one up. I was also quite interested in the notion that the basis of realization and of practice is learning. We in the West, especially it's interesting here at Stead College, we are constantly faced with this practitioner. Oh, you're an academic, you're a scholar, you're not a practitioner. And so to see that, and I know the text too, it goes back a long ways in a variety of different texts. Is that a widespread and accepted position in Burma generally? And do you have any pushback against that where people say, well, actually, no. Sitting is the basis of everything. And the book learning, because that's an old fact.
Oh, and certainly they develop traditions. I mean, the Mahansa tradition, for instance, it's not so much that they push back against the idea of the necessity of learning. It's my impression, is that they feel that learning ought not to be certain levels of learning or delving into detailed doctrinal teaching is inappropriate until you've reached a certain stage of practice. So it's sort of graded with the practice, which is quite different from sort of the upfront, kind of front-loaded, I guess you'd say, kind of method of learning. So there's wide purposes in Rome as well. If you look at something like the Paulo said, who I had the picture of in the end, this is another guy who essentially provides deep, deep instruction in doctrinal teaching, and Abhidhamma teaching in particular beforehand. But then, as I say, a teacher like the Mahasa Sayadaw, and many others as well, and Tejin, I suppose, but Tejin is a bit like this as well, will encourage us to be more experiential and like intrigued with the doctrinal teaching by practicing first. And so it's certainly present there, this sort of tension. I would argue that, in a sense, all of them sort of fall, though, on the spectrum towards the idea of the necessity of some learning as a kind of basis for the practice. Some more than others, for sure, but some learning undergird your practice and ensure its success.
Is that true of Goethe's too?
Yeah, well, he specifically says a unique theory, but he's rather on this graded method as well. Wait for the theory until you're ready for it. So if you go to one of his 10-day retreats, for instance, and his Dharma talks tend to be about an hour and 20 minutes long each, if you actually listen to this, it's incredibly detailed. By the time you get to the end of just that 10-day retreat, which is often framed for a person who's never meditated before or has any knowledge of Buddhism, you've gone through all the basics, basically. You've gone through the hindrances, and certainly you've gone through the aggregates, and you've gone through the 12th chain of origination, and many, many other aspects of the tradition. So you've actually gone through all the kalapas, of course, and some kind of overtly Abhidhamic elements. Now, the kalapas as a term is not present in the suttas, but of course the idea of earth, wind, fire, and water as its elements is. But it comes to have this kind of Abhidhamic flavor as the days progress in the 10 days. So there's actually ends up being a lot of the kind of core theory of meditation. So I would argue that he slightly grades it, but just over the kind of initial 10 days of one's introduction to meditation. Yes? Yes.
So I'm wondering if your sense of or the status of women in the lineage at the present time.
Sam Lajan, yes. that also is fairly distinctive. There certainly is a strong sense that, that you know, practice and awakening is available to everybody on a kind of theoretical level. That doesn't mean an actual sociological level that things necessarily have, you know, equal availability. Typically, the women teachers are for the women, the men are for the men in terms of the actual practicing retreat. But she has come to be, she was widely recognized by Ubah Khin as his sort of successor. And in fact, there's been a big break between her and the Essene-Goinga folks. So they don't really, they've sort of gone their separate ways. But she technically is actually the head of the lineage that follows from Ubah Khin. And Essene-Goinga sort of kind of goes off and creates a parallel track. I think to their great consternation, he's just become so widespread, people assume he's the kind of direct flow. But she is actually the head teacher, now lives in England. Does that answer your question?
Do you know if she has any other successors?
I don't know whether she has. I don't know. I know of some male teachers, in fact, but I'd be very surprised. I'd be very surprised if there weren't women teachers who follow from her. It seems like it's a bit like Goinga, though I know less about her lineage, that they're very conservative about allowing teaching by anyone but the sort of head teacher. So in Goinga, that means you watch videotapes of Goinga, you go to attend their retreat, and the assistant teacher just answers questions, so the actual person is sitting there. And in her retreats, I believe it's somewhat similar, but I don't know the definitive for sure.
Will monks learn?
They do from Goinga, but I don't know. I've never actually been told that the monks study there, but I'd be rather surprised if there weren't some who do. I mean, she mostly teaches in England, and you would suspect there especially there would be less hesitation. But at the same time, you know, as traditionally that would be very unusual, so I suspect it's not widespread. Generally speaking, monastics attend, say, Goinga retreats. I know that, but it's in relatively small numbers usually.
So she's still actively teaching?
She is, in the countryside outside of London. No. But they have centers too, but there's a much smaller number than Goinga. There's one in Maryland, if I'm not mistaken.
Thank you very much, Erik.
Perfect timing, you just shut it down.
Thank you.
Did you do it?
Yeah, she told me she was his own.
Yeah. You never know.
But I think you may have worse.
No, no, I was going to say I have less.
That's cheesy.